suddenly aware that in my solitude there is an absence. A face not there.
They had gathered here, these friends and family of Raffaele Favero, to share their sorrow and by so doing to soften their grief. The man they mourned had died 6 weeks earlier in Afghanistan.
I remember when Raffaele returned from Afghanistan the first time and he came home.
The Mujahideen, the freedom fighters with whom he'd shared his life and ultimately his death, buried him as Shaheed, a martyr in a holy war.
And he came back and he said, "Jill, it is worse than we could have imagined."
For both his friends and family, the remoteness of his death served only to heighten the loss. This gathering would help ease that burden.
"But it's not your holy war." And he said, "Yes, it is. It's everybody's holy war." And from that moment, I knew that his time with us was limited.
The war in Afghanistan, a conflict condemned by many, championed by few. When the Soviet military machine swept into this landlocked strategic country in December 1979, the West was outraged. Immediately there were trade embargoes, sanctions, and boycotts. As a deterrent, they proved futile. While the West salved its conscience, the Soviets consolidated their hold, moving through these ancient mountains with the awesome armory of modern warfare. These tribal areas were soon to become a testing ground for the latest in Soviet military might. As resistance from the Mujahideen increased, so too did the Soviet response. Entire villages were razed in indiscriminate bombing attacks. Many died. Others would carry their scars for life. Traditional grazing areas became the devil's playground, seeded from above with deadly anti-personnel mines. These innocent-looking explosive devices, nicknamed butterfly mines, exacted a terrible toll. With the upsurge in fighting, the flow of refugees into Pakistan, which began as a trickle, became a flood. More than 4 million Afghans have now fled their homes and taken refuge in northern Pakistan. There, in the dirt and squalor of tent cities, they are largely forgotten. Like the war raging in their homeland, they quickly faded from the television screens and the newsstands. The West, hungry for causes, had already moved on, fueled by the nightly carnage from far more accessible war zones. Afghanistan and its sufferings were yesterday's news. The Mujahideen needed a champion, a conduit to the West. They were to find one in Raffaele Favero. This Italian-born adventurer, who had dabbled in many things in a crowded life, had a continuing love affair with Afghanistan. To Favero, it was the last frontier, the ultimate journey. For 6 years, until 1973, he lived there speaking the local languages, adapting to the lifestyle of its tribal people, and converting to Islam. It was there that he met Jill, his wife-to-be, over breakfast in a seedy hotel in Kabul, early in 1972.
Well, he had really dark hair at the time. His hair was dyed black to go in Afghanistan. And I thought he looked like a really typical Italian, and I was a little wary.
However, that initial wariness was quickly to give way to stronger emotions. 2 years later, in Milan, they were married. Eventually, they were to settle in Maryborough, a small town northwest of Melbourne. These were the gentle days of Favero's life, in a land far removed from Afghanistan, both in terms of distance and lifestyle. They raised a family. First to arrive was Adam. 3 years later came Jana, and finally, Ria. Favero, with his exuberant nature and careless disregard for convention, became somewhat of a local identity. A talented artist and craftsman, he created striking and intricate stained glass work. These images, like the films that were soon to follow, would endure part of his legacy. Favero worked also with the young unemployed in the town. However, there was a certain restlessness. Favero needed challenges, mountains to climb. The Soviet invasion of Afghanistan was to crystallize those yearnings. He decided to return to find out what was happening.
He bought a Super 8 camera just in case he had a chance to get some footage. And he was in for about 3 months and came back just saying, "It's worse than we could have ever imagined."
Although the Mujahideen didn't know it at the time, they had found their champion. Raffaele Favero had found his destiny. Over the next 3 years, Favero was to spend 11 months with the Mujahideen. Covering this war would require a total commitment of body and spirit. He had already taken a Muslim name, Rafaula. Then came the physical transformation. He dyed his hair black and changed his clothes to blend in with the land and its people. There were to be no armchair helicopter rides to and from the front, as is so often the case for those covering modern wars. This was a land where methods of transport had changed little in thousands of years. To reach the battlefront meant a physically sapping trek through mountain country. Favero quickly discovered that to survive the physical hardships and the dangers, he would need to be one with the Mujahideen. He shouldered a captured Kalashnikov, along with his camera and tripod. It was expected that he share the burden of transport, be it arms or supplies, and he knew that in order to survive, he might need to fight himself. This was neither the time nor the place for the pretext of impartiality.
I can be as much as objective as an Afghan freedom fighter, I think. I've been there before, I know the language. I asked many people what they thought about the Russian. I have taped interview of many people. I visit all the refugee camps. I've seen million people in distress. I've saw people without legs because their village has been destroyed. I saw people without land. I mean, it's very difficult for me to believe that there might be another point of view, really. Even if they are successful on land, their main lack of defensive stance on air, like the helicopters. The helicopters really are master of the air. When the helicopters come, they can't do anything else than look for cover or run away, because they use Mi-24 new helicopters. They are titanium plated. Even a rocket can't do anything to them. They have laser rangers, they have sophisticated TV cameras and electronic sensors. 128 of those rockets, heat rockets, they follow the heat. I mean, it's really impossible for the Afghan that is not a regular army, you know. They go around fighting the Russian with turban and sandals and 303 rifles. How can they face such a modern weapon like a helicopter gunship?
When Favero made that first pilgrimage back to Afghanistan in 1980, very little news of the war was filtering out. A small number of Western journalists had gone in, but most were not to stay for long, finding it difficult to adapt to the lifestyle of the Mujahideen, an essential prerequisite to report on this war in any depth. Favero, with his knowledge of their ways and his ability to converse with them in their native Pashto, quickly won their trust and confidence. Unlike other Western journalists, he would not be a burden on this ragtag army, which in these early days marched to battle on little more than a prayer. Favero was intent on showing the human face of these tough tribesmen, as well as their skill as warriors. He was the first Westerner to obtain an intimate view of the Mujahideen. For Favero, it was almost like old times, when he'd roamed these same hills. But with one important difference, the Soviet presence. Like birds of prey, the gunships searched them out. As the Mujahideen became bolder and more successful, they began to accumulate an arsenal of modern weapons, most captured from their enemies. Now the helicopters, even the Soviet jets, began to feel the wrath of the Mujahideen. Here was the proof, proudly displayed for Favero's camera. No longer were these sophisticated machines of war safe to roam at will.
Since he has this Chinese anti-aircraft 14.5mm machine gun, Russian helicopters and jets don't come here anymore. They are afraid.
Now, by the grace of Almighty, we have so much equipment from the Russians themselves that we can employ them in effective operations. At times, the difficulty of ammunition does come, but we can get ammunition, arms, as only from the Russians themselves.
Therefore, their military successes served only to increase the Mujahideen's faith in Allah, for this was always a holy war. Islam pervades their lives. They pray before battle, during battle, and if they are to die, they do so willingly, secure in the belief that they will die shaheed and will be assured of paradise.
Allahu Akbar.
On all his trips to Afghanistan, Favero journeyed with the Mujahideen group led by Jalaluddin, a renowned commander, religious leader, and later to become defense minister in a major alliance of rebel groups known as Ittihad. Theirs was a bond of deep friendship and respect. Each time he returned, Favero would bring gifts, small tokens by Western standards, but gratefully received by this Mujahideen leader and his followers. Some of Favero's most graphic footage came on his second trip in 1981, when he spent nearly 2 months in the Zermatt district, covering a battle for a strategic government garrison town. This battle became known as the Siege of Tamir. It also marked a change from the traditional hit-and-run tactics of the Mujahideen. Now they were becoming more organized, more conscious of the need to plan their battles. Moving heavy weapons to the front line without the benefit of modern transport presented enormous problems. This recoilless rifle, which was to play a vital role in the siege of Tamir, was carried first by camel, then by horse, and finally by the Mujahideen themselves. A lull in the battle provided Favero with an ideal opportunity to be the consummate war correspondent, a role he played with a fine sense for the dramatic.
Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We are just about to prepare the recoilless rifle 75mm to shoot Tamir Tower. Zermatt, Afghanistan, 26 August, Mujahideen National News.
In this almost medieval setting, the warriors of Allah fought and defeated the infidel, the unbeliever, with the very weapons he'd brought into this land, hoping to subjugate its people.
He was going to go in for 2 months, and he came back after nearly 4 months. And for that 7 weeks, I didn't hear anything from him. And I was just terrified all the time. And the kids were getting worried. It was very hard for me to say, yes, Daddy is coming back. And I found that I could never say to them, definitely this coming back, because I didn't ever... Every time he went away, I thought that it could have happened. And every time he went away, really, I waited for a knock on the door saying that he's not going to come back.
In December 1982 came Favero's most ambitious project to date, AFSAT. Always a man with a flair for the unusual and a keen awareness of what would stir a lethargic Western media, he decided to attempt a world first. With the help of a team from Rai Television of Italy, the plan was to set up an outside broadcast operation inside Afghanistan to transmit a live battle scene by satellite around the world. The project was to prove a logistical nightmare. Equipment, including microwave dishes, had to be transported into Afghanistan, first by truck, then on horseback, and finally physically carried to the tops of mountains by the television team and their Mujahideen guides. The two attempted transmissions were plagued with technical problems. The first broadcast got through to Italy, but there was no sound, only vision. On the second attempt, they were beaten by something as simple as a flat battery. Favero and a friend tried everything to revive their only power source, to warm it back to life, but to no avail. In July 1983, Favero set out again for Afghanistan on what was to be his final journey. He quickly crossed from Pakistan and linked up with the forces of Jalaluddin, who were laying siege to the garrison town of Orgun in the Paktia province south of Kabul. In the weeks leading up to his arrival, the Mujahideen had successfully isolated the fort complex and its garrison of government troops and Soviet advisers. Relief convoys trying to reach the beleaguered defenders had been ambushed and destroyed. Orgun, which is close to the Pakistan border, is of immense strategic importance to both sides. The Soviets and their allies needed to control the area to retain a major road link from their northern bases to the southern part of the country. The Orgun Valley is also a crucial staging point for incursions into the mountain areas, traditional Mujahideen strongholds. The Soviets, aware of the importance of this battle, kept up a continuous air bombardment using their most modern fighter bombers and helicopter gunships. For Favero, his stay in Orgun this time was to be brief. Favero had already made plans for a unique trek to the Wakhan Corridor, formerly Afghan territory, but annexed since 1981 by the Soviet Union. The mountain region touches the borders of Russia, China, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. It was a journey that was to test Favero to the limits. Like others, he had heard strong and persistent rumors that the Soviets had built a forward launching base for their nuclear missiles in the Pamir Mountains inside the Soviet Union, a base said to be so remote and well hidden that even spy satellites could find no trace of it. For Favero, always on the lookout for a major scoop, the lure was irresistible. Their journey began in Pakistan, with a harrowing climb up precipitous mountain tracks barely wide enough for the vehicle. One moment of inattention, a rock slide, and Favero and his companions would have fallen many hundreds of meters to their deaths. When the roads ran out, they continued on horseback, the beauty and majesty of the surroundings giving no hint of the hardship and trauma ahead. In a letter to his wife shortly before setting out, and with the images of the battle for Orgun still fresh in his mind, Favero wrote, "We are planning a more peaceful glacier expedition." He was soon to realize he had badly miscalculated the task he had set himself. The local guides hired for this early part of the journey pointed out the Soviet presence in this highly sensitive area, a command post located near a strategic pass close to the Pakistan border. As they climbed higher, following the footsteps of Marco Polo, they came upon Lake Karamba, one of the highest watersheds in the world and the mother of three major river systems. Now their guides had turned back. Favero and his companion were alone, trespassers on the roof of the world.
We are at 4,200 meters here. We're just about to enter Pamir Mountains. There is China border, this Russian border, Afghanistan, Kashmir, and Pakistan. These high peaks just behind us, they are about 6,200 meters high. And today we have a couple of guests here. There's nobody here. We are absolutely lonely.
There were diversions, chance encounters, when time and space seemed suspended. These yaks roam the high mountain slopes. Many are domesticated and provide not only a sure-footed means of transport, but are valued also as a food source for their meat and their rich milk. Their fur and hides are used for clothing and shelter. Favero would meet again with the yaks of this region, but before then he would face his greatest challenge, the glaciers. On one occasion, Favero fell into a crevice, unknown to his companion who had gone on ahead. When his friend finally realized something was amiss, Favero was fighting to maintain his grip in an icy chasm and was in danger of succumbing to the intense cold. But they finally made it to the summit, and Favero exulted in the triumph.
Mamma mia! Finally we made it! We are at the Khorabhurt Pass, altitude 4,700 meters high, which is equivalent to 15,500 feet. Just imagine, just the altitude of the highest mountains in Europe. People in Europe used to go with ice picks, rampons, energy tablets, vitamins, months of jogging and mountaineering and practicing. We just came here with sticks. But we are exhausted. Nevertheless, we love it. We are now going inside Pamir. Pamir Bame Dunya, they call it. The roof of the world, the real roof of the world.
The rumored secret missile base was to elude them. It was simply too far into the mountains. Their energy, their food, and their time were running out. Then began the return journey, which again was to prove a test of spirit and endeavor. By this stage, the main concern was their dwindling food supply. Fearful that their presence might be reported to the Soviet authorities, they avoided the local inhabitants as much as possible. Deprived of the traditional hospitality of the mountain people, they were forced to rely solely on the provisions they had carried with them. This was the last of their supplies, some soup, bread, and tinned fish. With strict rationing, it would last them 3 days. Finally, the high plains. The glaciers were behind them. Once again, they were among people they could trust. Momentarily, they would forget the hunger and the danger that had been their constant companions for weeks. It was time now to relax, to be seduced by the setting and its strange inhabitants. For this was always a journey of contrasts, of ebb and flow. One moment danger, the next sheer delight. These last moments on the way back into Pakistan were to be savored. They left these mountains, Favero and his companion, their weary and footsore bodies wasted by the physical exertion and lack of food, but their spirits richer for the experience. There was the added satisfaction that they'd met the challenge of these formidable mountains, which for centuries had confused and dismayed those who had tried to penetrate them. Favero knew that he was one of the few Europeans ever to have made such a trip, and he was certainly the first to return with such a comprehensive film record. Later, Favero was to write, "It has not been easy, but by the grace of Almighty, we achieved again what we wanted." Back in Peshawar, Favero and his companion rested, recovering from the rigors of their mountain trek. Favero made plans to return to Australia, but then came news that the Mujahideen had captured the two auxiliary forts at Ubun. He decided footage of the sacked forts was essential to complete his film, and although still physically weak from the Pamir trip, he returned to Ugun late in September. The Mujahideen had taken the two forts after a prolonged siege. The government defenders, demoralized by the constant bombardment, finally surrendered. The debris of war was everywhere. The Soviet advisers also had left their mark. Even gifts from the West, wheat sacks from the United States and Canada, their original contents gone, replaced by sand to strengthen the fortifications. The Mujahideen now were concentrating their attack on the main fort and garrison. From a ridge some 3,000 meters away, they kept up a constant barrage. Each round was sent on its way with a prayer, and with the cry, "God is great." Across the valley, the accuracy of the Mujahideen gunners could be measured by the telltale wisps of smoke slowly curling above the ancient fort. As well as mortars, the government positions were under sustained attack from other heavy weapons. The Soviets, stung by these setbacks, visited their aerial wrath on the Ugun Valley almost daily, sometimes for hours at a time. Throughout it all, Favero kept filming, obtaining some remarkable close-up images. The Soviets were using parachute bombs, an ideal weapon for fast, low-level strikes. The drag created by the chute allows for greater accuracy and, more important, gives the aircraft time to safely clear the area before the ensuing explosions. At times, the bombs fell only a few hundred meters away from his exposed camera position. The Soviets were using some of their most sophisticated aircraft in these bombing raids. Favero was convinced he was the first Western cameraman to obtain footage of the latest Soviet attack aircraft, the Sukhoi 25. According to Western military analysts, the Soviets are using these aircraft to perfect their low-level attack techniques. As well as the jets, helicopter gunships were used in a bid to search out and destroy the Mujahideen positions. This day, they were to have no success. For these devout Muslims, the time for prayer was sacred, even with the tank shells falling nearby. For them, the battle could wait. Favero found time during this barrage to make his own pertinent observations.
Same spot.
When the jets had temporarily departed and the tanks had retreated to the safety of their fortifications, the damage could be assessed. This deadly phosphorus bomb fell harmlessly in a field. Favero was keen to film such scenes, to show the West the extent and range of Soviet weaponry being used, not only against the resistance fighters, but also the local population. There were some deaths and injuries while Favero was in Orgun, but considering the scope and ferocity of the air attacks and shellings, the Mujahideen casualties were extremely light. For that, they could be thankful. Normally, their badly wounded die before they can receive adequate medical care. These lulls in the fighting were a welcome break, a chance to rest both the body and the mind. For a short time this late afternoon, the Orgun Valley was at peace. Inside the Mujahideen headquarters, the latest batch of Afghan army defectors was lined up as proof of the high desertion rate among government troops. One day, Favero counted 34 soldiers who had left their posts and crossed to the Mujahideen side. This once peaceful farming valley was now the most strategic battlefront in the Afghanistan war. For the first time, the various political factions of the Mujahideen set aside their differences and were fighting under one command, the newly formed Ittihad Alliance. This new face of the Mujahideen warfare was put forward as an example to resistance fighters in other provinces. The aerial bombardment was to continue almost unabated during Favero's return to Orgun. From his perch atop Jalaluddin's headquarters, he obtained this graphic visual record of Soviet military technology in action. Favero realized that if his films were to have any impact in the West, they must contain frontline footage. The Mujahideen, from the top commanders to the newest recruits, marveled at the courage of this Western cameraman. Favero already had accepted that he might die a violent death, and he had told a friend in his last days at Orgun that if that were to be his fate, then he would accept it readily. In the meantime, there was a war to be filmed. For the most part, these air attacks were ineffective, the high explosives carpeting the Orgun Valley in an almost haphazard manner. To the Mujahideen, these harmless bomb bursts were further proof, if it were needed, that God was on their side. For Favero, still weak from the Pamir expedition and tiring of the constant strain of battle, it was time to turn his thoughts towards home and family. Then, on October 20th, news filtered out of Afghanistan that Raffaele Favero had been killed. This photograph was taken on the morning of his death. At the time, Jill and the children were holidaying in Bali.
And a knock came at the door, and a voice said, "Jill," and I just had an immediate feeling that something was wrong. And I went out, and this man said, "I'm the Australian consul." And I just knew immediately that it was something, but I was still thinking that because I had a telegram saying, or telex saying, to contact Pakistan, I thought, Raphael, he may have been captured. That was always a big fear that I had, or that he was injured. And the consul just said, "Your husband's been killed in Afghanistan." He said that your husband's been killed by a Russian bomb. And that was all he could say. That's all the information he said. He could give me the date, and he could tell me that Raphael had been killed 10 days earlier and buried the day after that. And that was all he knew, and that was all he could say.
Jill learned that the Mujahideen had afforded her husband the ultimate tribute. They had buried him as Shaheed. Such a man is assured of a place in paradise. These shaky sequences of an ancient ritual were filmed by a Mujahideen friend using Favero's own camera, which had been damaged at the time of his death. These ragtag holy warriors grieved for the man who had won his way into their hearts with his courage and dedication to their cause. Although the images were less than perfect, they detracted nothing from the dignity of this final tribute. they had loved him also for the simple things. His infectious humour, his cavalier attitude to life, the shared experience of pitting themselves against seemingly insurmountable odds. For Raffaele Favero was, in many ways, a latter-day Don Quixote, a tilter at windmills, a man who raged at the obstacles life tends to place in the way of idealists, thinkers, and visionaries. His close friend, Jalaluddin, who had seen so many die, said that never before had he felt such pain at one man's death. Raffaele Favero was truly the champion the Mujahideen had sought. Now they bade him farewell. But then came the conflicting reports, suggestions that Favero had been crushed to death while filming a captured Soviet tank and had not died in an air attack, as had been first reported.
I started to really wonder about that, and really it became important for me to find out the exact circumstances of his death. Not that it changed anything.
Also, Jill was concerned for her children.
For the sake of the children, I was probably was the main reason that I had to find out, because from this, really, when I was told, I told the children, Adam immediately and the other two kids when they woke up the next morning. I've always shared how I feel with the kids or what's happening. We're always totally honest with them. And I couldn't say to them, Daddy's coming back, when he's not. So I had told them that. I told them it was a bomb. And I thought, then I have to find out exactly how he died, because if it wasn't from a bomb, I have to find that out now, and I have to tell them. And so it was basically that reason that I decided to go back to Pakistan, because that's the only place that I could find out exactly what happened.
On December the 22nd, 9 weeks after Raffaele Favero's death, his family arrived in Peshawar, the noisy, dusty capital of the Northwest Frontier Province. It took Jill only a short time to establish the exact circumstances of her husband's death. The details were painful, the renewed grief hard to bear.
Very quickly I was in touch with Mujahideen, the fighters he'd been with, and they told me that he'd been crushed by a tank while he was filming.
It was late in the afternoon of October the 10th. Favero planned to leave Orgun the following day on his way back to Australia. But first, he wanted film of this captured tank being driven by its Mujahideen crew. In the total of 11 months he'd spent in Afghanistan covering the war, he had accumulated many hours of film. This was to be his last footage. First, he filmed the tank crossing this small river. Then he waded to the other side and indicated that he wanted the tank to come towards him. Through the viewfinder, he watched the tank approaching. Suddenly, it was upon him.
His first reaction was to throw his camera to safety, and there was only one cry, like, of realization of what was happening. Not even pain, because the injury was too great for that. But it was like a cry of realizing that he was going to die. He was just lying with his eyes open, but not speaking or not seeing. Who knows in those few seconds what could go through his mind. Ironically, his last words to a friend in Peshawar were, "I want to get a picture of a tank moving so the audience thinks it's going to roll on top of them."
Fatally injured, he clung to life for some 20 minutes, dying in the arms of an English friend who had accompanied him from Pakistan to Orgun. To be killed, to be Shaheed, had often been a topic of conversation between Favero and his Mujahideen brothers.
They're quite happy if they become Shaheed. Shaheed means martyr, somebody who died in battle. And I spoke with some of them and they say, pray Allah that they might become Shaheed.
Although the conflict over Raffaele Favero's death has been resolved, the shock and confusion linger still. The reasons for those initial reports blaming his death on a Soviet air attack may never be known.
One of the main things is that everyone involved at that stage was so shocked and so confused that and so upset that in their hands the man that they loved and was working for them had died, even though it was accidental, that any decisions made were totally out of shock. Maybe it was to relieve my feelings or the feelings of people in Australia who could say the Mujahideen have been careless and run over a Western journalist, which certainly weren't my feelings when I heard that it actually was a tank. I can't honestly say why.
There were other important tasks for Jill in Peshawar. She met Maulawi Nasrullah Mansour, General Secretary of the Ittihad Alliance. He, like so many of the Mujahideen, was to pay tribute to her husband. Such a man, he said, was the most beloved of God. Jill and the children also visited Nasir Bagh, a refugee camp housing some 30,000 inhabitants near Peshawar. A special area of the camp has been set aside for the widows of those who had been killed in Afghanistan. And this was to provide Jill with one of the most moving aspects of her trip.
It was unique for the Afghan women to meet a Western woman in the same situation. And I think that is why they just all came, they'd embrace me or embrace or touch the children or pray for their happiness and health. May Allah bless them, everybody said. They're special children. The Mujahideen said it would be possible for me to go inside Afghanistan in a very safe area. They were taking such care of us, they would put us in no danger at all. I felt totally safe and totally protected with them, and their feelings for the children, I knew that they would put them in no danger. So when the opportunity arose to actually go into Afghanistan and into a Mujahideen headquarters there, I jumped at the chance.
Jana and Adam, like their father had done so many times before, would need first to disguise their Western appearance. Three-year-old Ria would keep her blonde hair. Jill had decided to smuggle her across the border, hidden beneath her burqa, the traditional veil dress of the local women. They journeyed into Afghanistan in the back of a Mujahideen vehicle, and apart from a few anxious moments when they were thoroughly searched by a suspicious border patrol, the trip to the headquarters was uneventful. For Jill and the children, unable to visit Raphael's grave at Orgun because of the continued heavy fighting, this place would help give shape and substance to his death.
It was probably the best thing at the time for me to go into Afghanistan and for the children to go in. On the way in, the children were saying, is this the way Daddy went in? Is this where he stayed? Did he know that man? Or the men would talk to him and say, your daddy's been here, I knew him. And it really crystallized in our minds what it was like for him and the feelings he generated amongst the Afghans that he was working with. And his own feelings, how he became so involved and wanted to go back and back, because I can myself, even though he was talking about it, it wasn't until I went in and saw the situation myself to understand how this mission could arise in him.
The Mujahideen were to open their hearts to these special children, and they, in turn, would momentarily soften the starkness of this setting with its instruments of war and death. For Jill Favero, this trip, this pilgrimage, would serve only to strengthen her commitment to the Afghan cause. This, she says, is the least she can do for the man the Mujahideen saw as their champion, and she remembers simply as my cavalier.
It was an amazing experience, I mean, just in the time that we had together. And if I can think that the children, like, what a situation for the children to lose their father at such a young age, but they were very lucky children to have had him at the time they did. He was a very special man.
Came here with sticks, but we are exhausted. Nevertheless, we love it.
are at 4,200 meters here. We're just about to enter Pamir Mountains.
Although he was a foreigner, he was fighting for the cause, not with a gun, but with a camera. And that to them was just as important.
Sumat, Afghanistan, 26 August, Mujahideen National News.
The date, October the 11th, 1983. The place, Irgun, Paktia Province, Afghanistan. Maulawi, Jalaluddin Haqqani, Mullah and Defense Minister of Ittihad, delivered this moving oration to Raffaele Favero. As he was alone here with us, it was imperative for us to give him all the religious honors deserved by a martyr in a holy war. Will you believe me, the thousands of people have been shaheed, and I have never felt the quantity of pain that I feel now. He did not work for any government, but as an individual, he was here helping us in our cause, and for that reason, I respect him most.